-0.6, which is our low reading. Now, when we check the collector, we should expect the same reading. And we get it again, 0.6. Now, if we reverse the leads and put our negative lead on the base, if we check the emitter, we get an infinite reading. We check the collector, we get an infinite reading. So we got a high front-to-back ratio. Now the last thing we have to check is collector to emitter. So we check it in one direction, it reads infinity. We check it in the other direction, and it also reads infinity. Now let's take a look at one more transistor. Here is a big power transistor, and if you remember, on the portion of the tape that we discussed the basing diagrams, on this type of transistor, the two leads fall out to one half of the body of the transistor. So holding it this way, you notice that the leads are more to the bottom. And the lead configuration on this transistor would then be emitter, base, and this outside shell would be the collector. So again, we go through the same procedure. We put our positive lead on the base, and now we check the emitter, and we get our low reading. We check our collector, and again we get a low reading. Now you'll notice that the emitter reading and the collector reading are not exactly the same, but they're both low and they're both within reason. Now we reverse the leads and we put the negative lead on the base. We checked the emitter, we checked the collector, and we get an infinite reading. So we have our high readings. Now we go to the emitter to collector, infinity, and now we go from collector to emitter, and again infinity. So now you can see that what we've been saying is so. What we did in fact is we took a lead, we put it on the base, we checked the emitter and collector and got the same or similar readings. Then we reversed the leads, put the other lead on the base, checked the emitter and collector, and again got the same or similar readings. And then as a last final check to make sure that we don't have a short between emitter and collector, we went from emitter to collector and collector to emitter. And in both directions, we got an infinite reading. So the first two checks, emitter to base, base to collector, check like a diode, and emitter to collector, should be infinite in both directions. Now that we've done this, it's time for you to actually get out your meter, take out the transistors that we sent you, and check them. All but one are good. See if you can determine which one is bad. And when we come back, we're going to go over the GE manual and how we go about checking what type of transistor replaces what type of transistor. Okay, so go check your transistors now. When you come back with the GE manual. Okay, now that we've learned how to identify the leads on the transistor, and we've learned how to check them, and we understand the way they work, the last thing that we have to deal with is how do we find the replacement for one that we found that's defective? Well, let's assume that we have a transistor and we find it defective, and the number on the transistor is 2SC1308. And many times a transistor like this, on the transistor itself, it would only put C1308 because they assume that you know 2SC. 2SC is standard for transistors. Now, the way we look this up is we go to our GE replacement manual. Now, I've done some homework before, so I can tell you what page to look on. Now, if you look through the GE manual, you'll notice that items are listed first by number and then by letter. And within number, we would consider the number in this case to be 2, because that is the first number before we hit a letter. So we would look under 2. Now the way they have them numerically listed is they start off by single digits running 1 through 10, then they go to double digits 1 through 10, 10 through 100, Then they go to triple digits, quadruple digits, 5, 6, 7 digits, numbers up until the letters. Most transistors do not have only numbers. Some do, but not all of them. Most of them have a letter somewhere. And you count the number of digits before either a number or a dash. So in this case, we have the number 2. So if we take a look through our GE catalog, we'll come up to page 325. And if we look on page 325, about halfway down in the first column, we come up to the listing for a 2SC1308, and then there are some suffixes afterwards. They have a plain 1308, they got 1308K, 1308L, N, and then they go to 1309. So we would have to take a look at the original and see what the numbers are on there. Fortunately for us, most of them right now cross-reference, if you follow it across, to a GE 259. So if we wanted to see if that is the right transistor, and at least if, what type of transistor that is, we turn to the front of the book. Now if we take a look in the front of the book, we have a listing of all the GE replacements, and they're in numerical order so that we can look them up easily and see what they are. It gives a brief explanation of what they are. So if we look up a GE 259, which is on page 4, first column, about 10 items down, it says GE 259. The next column over says that the data for that transistor is on page 17, if you wanted to look up the data. Then it tells you that the type of case is a TO3 case, and that the diagram, the basing diagram for a TO3 case, can be found on page 47. Now, in most cases, all we would want to know is that a GE 259 is what we need. We would go down to our electronics distributor and purchase a 259 to replace the damaged transistor. And if you look a little further over, it says that it is N-TV horizontal output. Well, N means that it's an NPN, and TV horizontal output means that it's a power transistor. Understanding all the shorthand that they have in here will come with time as you use this reference manual. But for now, let's just take a look at our basing diagram and see what it's all about. So we turn to page 47. And if we take a look on page 47, halfway down on the right-hand side of the page, we have the TO3 case. And the TO3 case is a standard power output case. And you'll notice it gives the basing configuration, also the dimensions, if you were engineering something, which we're not really concerned about. So now we've come from the number of 2SC1308, and we found out that a GE 259 will replace that. So we can purchase a GE 259, and we finished our job. Well, I would suggest that this time, what you do, we only have one more topic to cover on this tape, and that's going to be soldering and handling double-sided circuit boards. I would suggest that this time you take the transistors that we sent along with this course and look them all up in the book just for practice. If you have any problems with this section or any other section, remember that I'm always available on the phone Tuesday through Saturday, 9 to 5, and the 800 number is in the front of the catalog that came with this tape. So at this time, take a look at those transistors, look them up in the manual, and when we come back to the tape, have your soldering equipment ready so that we can work on soldering on dual-sided circuit boards. Okay, we're down to the final piece of this tape, and in this section, we're going to cover desoldering techniques to be used on double-sided board. Now, to better understand what we're up against, I think it's important that you understand first the way the boards are made and we get some terminology straight. Okay, the board starts out as one complete laminated board, and when we say a laminated board, we mean it's some fiber-type material. And on both sides, on the top, and we're looking at it from the flat side now, on the top and on the bottom there is a thin coating of copper. Now, on microprocessor boards, usually the traces or the